about to introduce is a rare talent. He not only sings, he sings fine gospel, but he's a fantastic writer. His composition of my tribute can be found in many of our modern day hymnals. He's a Grammy Award winner four times over, a dynamic performer. Ladies and gentlemen, my special guest star, Andrae Crouch.
I'm so glad for the very promise of the Lord. And whether you believe it or not, we can really say a song that I put together some time ago, but it says, soon and very soon, we're going to see the King. If you feel like clapping your hands, do so, it's okay.
Good evening and welcome to the Dusty Road Show with your radio host, Jerry, on Feature Tonight. And our featured artist is the late Andrae Crouch, who just went to be with the Lord this past year and is greatly missed. And anyway, I'd just like to welcome you all and hope you all had a happy Valentine's Day. And Anyway, with that in mind, let's continue on with more music by Andrae Crouch and the Disciples right here on IndieGospelRadio.org, featured tonight. God bless.
Our first guest. Billy Graham called him the greatest hymn writer of our age, the modern-day John Wesley. The object of that flattering assessment? Andrae Crouch. And apparently the recording industry agrees. Winner of 5 Grammys for his gospel albums, Andrae is listed in ASCAP's top 100 composers. But the essence of an Andrae Crouch performance is more than the hymns he writes. It's the infectious way he reaches out and ignites his audience. He and his fire-breathing backup singers have torn up and sold out the Royal Albert Hall in London, the Sydney Opera House in Australia, Madison Square Garden, Radio City Music Hall, and 3 times he turned Carnegie Hall upside down. The modern gospel approach, fusing rhythm, blues, and rock with his deep religious fervor, has been seen on television specials all over Europe. And you're about to see it and feel it now. You're about to join the flock of Andrae Crouch.
Can't nobody do me like Jesus, because he's my friend. I repeat, can't nobody do me like Jesus. Hey, nobody do me like the Lord, no,
do me like the Lord.
Can't nobody do me like Jesus.
Do me like Jesus.
He's my friend.
He's
yes, he is. What he did for me, I said he healed
my body,
and then he
told me to run.
I said he healed
my body,
and he told me to run. He said I couldn't get well, he healed me.
Told me to run.
I said to heal my body. Look at me now. He told me to run.
Told me to run.
Go find the way.
Kill
us, let me hear you. How you feel?
Well, I came to Jesus just as I was.
Love, no.
Do me like
free from the troubled water. He's my friend. I can lean on him. I can rest in him. Nobody does me like Jesus. I want all the brothers to say he. You gotta sing loud if you wanna reach up here. Come on. Let me tell you. Let me hear the sisters say. When demons hear it, they got the mood. They can't stand it. They start trembling at the sound of the name.
Father's church, and I don't read music. I learned as my father needed a piano player in his church. He's here tonight, but he needed a piano player, and he prayed for me one Sunday. And I started playing the piano about 3 weeks later. And because I really didn't like math too much, I couldn't understand music at all the 16ths. I play all of them, but I couldn't understand it, and to this day I can't. It's just too much for my
eyes.
Files
of Unshackled, so Pacific Garden Mission presents Free Indeed.
I was born in Japan. When war with America came, my older brothers joined the fighting. Then the government took our home to construct an evacuation shelter. My father also lost his business, then grew ill and died. Our new home was destroyed by bombs, and we lived on an open field in a house made of apple crates. My brothers had little to come home to, and my life was in ruins with no future. But someone's kindness allowed me to attend high school. I excelled in English and joined a men's choir. When the choir added female voices from a mission school, we had to attend the mission church. I went but had no interest in any religion, only singing. That was the first time I heard a Bible message or sang hymns, but I still had no interest in religion. With no money for higher education, I joined Japan's self-defense forces as a liaison officer using my English skills. Because of that ability, a missionary used me as his interpreter on Sundays. Week after week, as I interpreted, his message found a home in my heart. I was literally preaching to myself when I interpreted, "For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." The message struck my heart. That day I repented of my sins, asking Jesus to save me and my life. I'm Kazuo Ozaki. If the Son therefore shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed.
If you would like to be free from the weight of sin by receiving Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, call 1-888-NEED-HIM right now. Free Indeed is a production of Pacific Garden Mission, 1458 South Canal Street, Chicago, Illinois, 60607.
Trouble is in my way. I can't tell my night from day. When I'm tossed from side to side, like a ship out on a raging tide. I don't worry, I don't fret. My heart has never failed me yet. Troubles come from time to time. If that's all right, I'm not to worry inclined. Because I've got confidence, God is gonna see me through. What the case may be, I know it's gonna fix it for me. I've got confidence, God is gonna see me through. No matter what the case may be, I know it's gonna fix it for me.
Job was sick so long, till the flesh fell from his bones. His wife, cattle and children, everything that he had was gone. But Job in his despair, he knew that God still cared. Sleepless days and sleepless nights, but Job said, that's all right. Because I've got confidence, and my Lord is gonna see me through. No matter what the case may be,
I know he's gonna fix it for me.
Lord gave it to me,
I've got confidence.
He told me a secret, no matter what the case may be,
I know he's gonna fix it for me.
Some people wonder how I smile, even when I'm going through trials. They say, Andrae, how can you have a song when everything is going wrong? But I don't worry, I'm no friend.
I don't worry.
Troubles come from time to time, but that's alright, I'm not the worried kind. Because I've got confidence, my Lord will see me through. No matter what the case may be, I know he's gonna fix it for me. Whoever you are today, Lord will see you through. No matter what your case may be, he said he'd fix it for you.
Song.
The Lord Jesus said for me.
Calvary. The blood that gives me strength from day to day. It will never lose its power, for it reaches to the highest mountain. At a friend's house, and they were having a picnic in the backyard. But none of these artists that were there were songwriters. But I was too afraid to go in the backyard, you know, I was too shy. And Sandra was with me, my twin. And I'm very hoarse, by the way. Sandra was with me, and a guy named Billy Preston. And I said, boy, I wish I could write a song. And I asked God, right then, I was 14 years old, and I said, I wish, God, you would give me a song. And 4 minutes later, I went to the piano. The people didn't even know that we had arrived. I started playing this song, that song I just played. It was talking about the blood of Jesus. Not the idea. The reason why I talked about the blood of Jesus, because they were putting these ribs in some barbecue sauce.
You're 14 years old.
Yeah, 14.
And this is the first song you've ever written.
First song.
And you come up with this within how much time?
5 minutes.
Give me a little sample. 5 minutes, you sit down, and how did the experience begin? Had you heard those chords before?
No. No, it's just, I just started playing it.
All right, go ahead.
Back on Calvary, the blood gives me strength from day to day. It will never lose its power. And it talks about the blood of Jesus. And then I saw Jesus going up a hill, being whipped by soldiers. And so that gave me the mountain light. So I said, it reaches to the highest mountain. Germany the other day, and he called me and said, Andrae, I was just at a service at some cathedral in Germany, and he said, I saw about 3 or 4 of your songs in the hymn books. So it's been recorded probably by other artists at least 3,000 times at least. And
you better. I'm
so delighted to be here tonight, and I'm grateful for Jesus Christ and for what he means to me. And I don't know how I got here on Indian night, but I'm here. I'm so grateful today because I can say that I have Christ in my life. And at the early age of 9 years old, I gave my heart to Jesus. My father was what we call a bootleg preacher. He didn't want to own up to being a preacher. He was in Bible college, and he never wanted to be a preacher. He was a businessman. And nevertheless, the Lord kept talking to him. And once the Lord puts a hook in your jaw, you can't escape. And I remember him being invited to a little church about 60 miles out from Los Angeles, where we are from. And this was a little church, the kind of church that even had the little outhouse in the back. And there was no musician there or anything. And my dad didn't know whether it was the Lord's will for him to be there, because he didn't want to be a preacher anyway. And they said, oh, this is our pastor. And they wanted him so much to be the pastor of this little country church after hearing him speak that afternoon. And time went on, and my uncle, which is a presbyter of Southern California, asked him, he said, Ben Crouch, why don't you go out there and just kind of get the church organized? He said, well, being that the church doesn't have a musician, I'm going to pray, if God wants me to be there, I'm going to pray that God will give Andrae the gift of music so he can play for the church. And I had just accepted the Lord at the age of 9, and I was about 11 years old at the time. And my dad calls me up out of the audience and says, Andrae, if God were to give you the gift of music, would you use it for his glory? I said, yeah, Daddy. You know. And then he prayed for me right there. And 2 weeks later, he said, okay, here you are. And he just stuck me up on the piano. I began to play. And I had a bad stammering problem. I couldn't say over 3 words without either kicking somebody or pounding the floor, something like that. And I wanted so much to express myself. And I was so grateful for the gift of music and how God had touched my life. And right there, I knew that God was going to use me. And I was just sharing with Brother Graham how, watching some of the telecast, how I was so blessed, and I said, oh, if I could just sing and people would be there and find Jesus, you know. And it just impressed my life and put a just really enriched my life at a very early age. And now God has taken us to about 40 different countries of the world, and I've seen him do so many miracles. How 3.5 years ago, I was sick unto death, and I found Jesus Christ to be a healer. And I tell you, he's everything. And I'm just trying to tell everybody, all the young people especially, in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he'll direct your path. You'll never regret any moment that you've given your heart to Jesus. And a song that he's given me after a hard time in my life, a particular time I thought I couldn't sing, I thought I couldn't smile, but he gave me this little song, and I trust that it should be a blessing to you.
I've had many tears and sorrow. I've had questions for tomorrow. There've been times when I didn't know right from wrong. But in every situation, God gave me blessed consolation. That all my trials come to only make me strong. Places, and I've seen millions of faces, but there were times when I felt so all alone. But right there in my lonely hour, it became a precious lonely hour, for Jesus let me know that I was his own. Now I can say, I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God. Through it all. Through it all. Oh yes. I've learned to depend upon his word. So now I thank God for the mountain. And I thank him for the valleys. And I thank him for the storms. He's brought me through. For if I never had a problem, I'd never know that God could solve them. I'd never know what faith in the word of God could do. But now I can tell the world that through it all, don't you know I've learned to trust in Jesus? I've learned to trust in God. Let me tell you that through it all, through it all, oh yes, oh, I've learned to depend upon his word. Every child of God here tonight, you ought to thank God for every mountain. Thank him for those storms, all that he's bringing you through right now. Well, for if you never have a problem, you never know that God can solve them.
You'll never know what faith in the word of God could do, but you can stand like a soldier and say, let's do it all. Or sometimes through the fire, let's do it all. Oh yes, don't you know I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God. You know I've learned to depend upon His word. Through my sickness and pain, I've learned to depend upon His word. When the doctor walked from my bed and shook his head, right then I learned to depend upon His
Andrae Crouch with Through It All on Featured Tonight, who just went to be with the Lord this past year, and he was a very great influence in the gospel music, him and his sister Sandra. And I really was inspired by Andrae Crouch when I first came to the Lord. When I first heard him, he's a great songwriter and singer and musician, and he influenced lots of people, myself, like I said, included, and greatly missed. So anyway, with that in mind, that brings us down to the news, and after that we're going to have more music for the soul and words to live by. So stay tuned with your radio host, Jerry, right here on IndieGospelRadio.org.
It's Friday, January 29, 2016. I'm Albert Moeller, and this is The Briefing, a daily analysis of news and events from a Christian worldview. The headline is indeed ominous. Zika virus spreading explosively. Level of alarm extremely high. Reporters Ariana Yujung Cha and Lena Sun, writing for The Washington Post, reported, the World Health Organization announced Thursday that it will convene an emergency meeting to try to find ways to stop the transmission of the Zika virus, which officials said is spreading explosively across the Americas. Margaret Chan, Director General of the World Health Organization, said, quote, the level of alarm is extremely high, as is the level of uncertainty. She went on to say, questions abound. We need to get some answers quickly. As the Washington Post went on to report, the World Health Organization said the pathogen, which was virtually unheard of in the region a year ago, is spreading so fast it could infect as many as 3 to 4 million people within the next 12 months. Chan said those numbers, as well as the severity of the possible conditions that are being reported, from brain defects in children to paralysis in adults, make the situation dramatically different from what epidemiologists have seen with the virus in the past. End quote. Now, as Christians look at this, we need to be very aware that this is a portrait in miniature, a portrait in reality, of the fallen world in all of its symptomology of the fall. The reality is that all kinds of evil, including both moral evil and what we call natural evil, that would include tsunamis, tornadoes, mosquitoes, and infectious diseases, they are evidence of the fall. And Christians must also keep something else in mind. During the last half of the 20th century, Americans grew accustomed to no longer worrying about infectious diseases. If you go back to the midpoint of the 20th century, you look at medical textbooks or just at the newspaper headlines, you will see a constant barrage of concern.
urgent life and death concern about any number of infectious diseases. They included mumps, encephalitis, measles, including rubella. They included polio and any number of other very infectious diseases that threatened to wipe out populations, to bring death and deformity and all kinds of horrifying effects to a human population. In great cities, there was always the danger of an epidemic breaking out. When Americans met others, for instance, in the context of war, there was always the possibility that an epidemic could spread from one place to another, as did the great influenza in the second decade of the 20th century that killed millions of people worldwide. Killed more people, we should note, than all of those killed in the theaters of war during World War I. But by the second half of the 20th century, Americans believed, and we allowed ourselves to believe, that we had largely conquered infectious diseases. The development of modern antibiotics is something that dates back really only to the last half of the 20th century. And the medical marvels that came with vaccinations and immunizations and all of these antibiotics, along with various forms of treatment and the avoidance of disease, that meant that most Americans now alive really haven't worried too much about the effects of an infectious disease. Certainly, they weren't worried that it would be something that would be life-threatening to themselves or potentially to their offspring. But even as we are rightly thankful for all these medical marvels, in the end, we have to be very careful that our confidence is never fully placed in them. Our confidence must ultimately be in God. And our awareness must be that even as we have pressed back against these diseases and new ones, including the Zika virus and in the future, viruses and infectious agents not yet known, will press against us. And that's exactly what we are seeing now. The first recent headlines about the Zika virus came about 3 weeks ago, and they told us of an outbreak of this mosquito-borne disease in Latin America, in Central and South America, in the Caribbean Basin, not in the United States. As a matter of fact, those early headlines, or at least the early news story, said, Americans really don't need to worry about this. Now you have the Washington Post, for instance, running an entire series of articles, including the one with the headline that the Zika virus is spreading explosively, and that the level of alarm is extremely high. As relates to the United States, a different Washington Post story with the headline, Why the United States is so vulnerable to the alarming spread of the Zika virus, Lena Sun and Brady Davis reported, with the Zika virus now circulating in 24 countries and territories across the Americas, the mosquito-borne pathogen seems destined to reach the United States and probably sooner rather than later. What is far less certain, they wrote, say public health and infectious disease experts, is Zika's potential reach and impact here. The South, they write, is particularly vulnerable because of its warm, humid climate and pockets of poverty where more people live without air conditioning or proper window screens. Plus, says the Post, the region is already home to mosquitoes that can transmit the virus. The Washington Post summarizes that some infectious disease models estimate that as many as 200 million people live in areas that might be conducive to the spread of Zika during the summer months. That would include the East and West Coast and much of the Midwest. Now, remember that the total population of the United States is something just over 300 million. So this is 2 out of 3 Americans, according to these models of a potential epidemic. What we know about Zika right now is that the current outbreak had its epicenter in Brazil. And in Brazil, there are believed to be now thousands and thousands of people who have been infected with the disease. Medical authorities tell us that only about 1 out of 5 of all those who will develop the disease after being bitten by a mosquito will show any symptoms or any effects, at least immediately, of the disease itself. But it is now believed that the Zika virus can lead to paralysis in adults and to deformities in babies when the mother, who is pregnant, develops the disease in the course of the pregnancy. Microcephaly, which is a condition in which the baby is born with a smaller than usual head leading to brain damage, that is now causally linked to the Zika virus, at least in terms of the fact that an unusually large number of thousands of babies born with the condition in Brazil and elsewhere came with the disease and only in connection to the disease. It's the only causal link that has yet been identified. That's very scary. Americans of a certain age can think back to the 1950s and the 1960s, even into the 70s and beyond, when scares about pregnant women in the United States developing rubella were very, very similar. The scale of the threat is now represented by a medical response, not just from the World Health Organization, but from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention in the United States and various other governments and NGOs all across the region. Reporting for Atlantic Monthly, Taja Chapelet-Lanier tells us that countries across the affected region are coming up with, as she said, various ways to protect against the virus. Here is one of the most radical proposals. It tells us something, that in the year 2016, this is seriously being put forth by a government. Let me read from The Atlantic. Quote, in El Salvador, which has seen around 5,000 cases of Zika, officials are urging women not to get pregnant until 2018. Critics of the strategy worry about pregnancies that are unplanned. Jamaica, Colombia, and Ecuador have also recommended that their citizens delay pregnancy. Now just imagine that we could roll back time just a few days, just a few weeks. What if we were told that in the year 2016 there would come an official advisory from a government that the women in that country should not get pregnant for 2 years, until 2018? The Christian worldview reminds us of just how unlikely it is that that might happen, but it also tells us that something of incredible consequence is taking place here. Christians looking at this need to think very, very carefully. We need to be aware of the fact that certainly in the face of any kind of disease, this represents a real public health challenge. But we also have to recognize that ultimately our hope cannot be merely in technology or in medical science. It can't be merely in a serum or a vaccination, an immunization, or even an antibiotic. We also have to understand that when you have the intersection of some kind of medical emergency like this and a large population, people respond to fear, and that's what we're seeing. And fear can bring out the best and the worst in terms of human beings. And that is also reflected in another Washington Post article in the same series. In this one, Christopher Sherman and Marcos Alleman report that in the face of the Zika virus, women are pondering abortion and childlessness. Now again, we're talking about 2016. This kind of headline would have been virtually unimaginable just a matter of a few days ago, not to say just a couple of weeks ago. What we're looking at here is where we have to think very carefully. It is appropriate from the Christian worldview that we press upon governments and every responsible institution to respond to this in such a way as to bring hope and healing as quickly as possible. We are not opposed to modern medicine. To the contrary, it is the Christian worldview and its rational understanding of how the world operates because God made it in such a way and because of what we understand is the value of every single human life. That's why Christians have been at the forefront of the healing professions from the very beginning. And that is entirely appropriate. That's where we should be. And we should be pressing for every available resource to be directed towards the eradication of this disease and the alleviation of its consequences. But we also have to recognize that if we respond in abject fear, we will be driven away from our confidence in the gospel of Jesus Christ and to something else. And that is exactly what we see when a headline tells us that in the face of the spreading of the Zika virus, there is a new openness to abortion in a region of the world that had been very opposed to abortion even just a couple of weeks ago. And almost as predictably, Wired magazine had a headline yesterday that was this: Zika virus may push South America to loosen abortion bans. What does that tell us? It tells us that there are those right now who are prepared to seize upon this public health emergency in order to further their moral agenda. And what is that agenda? It is an agenda to legalize abortion and to loosen bans on abortion. But as the article by Sarah Zhang tells us, there are those who right now want to seize upon this disease as an opportunity to try to further the cause of legalizing and, to use the word in this article, destigmatizing abortion in Latin America. Biblically minded Christians take death and disease very seriously. We understand that they are real. We do not, like Christian scientists, deny that disease and death are realities. And we also understand that we should be on the front lines of pressing back against these diseases and that we validate legitimate medical approaches to eradicate and alleviate disease. And we should not only welcome them, we should press for them. But we also need to keep in mind that every emergency brings an opportunity for that which is even worse. In this case, the opportunistic seizing upon an epidemic in order to further the cause of abortion rights. We must keep in mind that it is the Christian conviction of the sanctity and dignity of every single human life that undergirds the integrity of any proper approach to medicine in the first place. Next, also on the issue of the sanctity and dignity of human life, we shift to a story, a big story that broke this week from Jerusalem. Isabel Kirshner, reporting for the New York Times, tells us, after he was convicted and sentenced to death in Israel for his role in the annihilation of millions of Jews by Nazi Germany, Adolf Eichmann pleaded for his own life. Adolf Eichmann, you may remember, was the architect of what was called by the Nazi regime the Final Solution, the effort to eradicate Europe of all living Jews. The Third Reich, under the leadership of Adolf Hitler, ultimately, and the Nazi regime, sought to eradicate the Jewish people from the face of the earth, to use the very words of Adolf Hitler. Adolf Eichmann was one of Hitler's lieutenants. He was one of those, specifically, the point person to develop the way the Final Solution would be carried out. That plan was plotted out and finally confirmed at an infamous gathering that took place in Wannsee, that is, a suburb outside of Berlin, about the midpoint of World War II, and Adolf Eichmann was at the very center of it. At the end of World War II, as the Nazi regime fell, Adolf Eichmann disguised himself and escaped to Buenos Aires, Argentina, where he was finally found by Simon Wiesenthal and other Nazi hunters and brought to Israel for trial. That trial took place in 1961. Eventually, in May of 1961, Adolf Eichmann became the only person judicially executed in the history of the State of Israel, executed for the crime of the murder of millions of Jewish people during the Holocaust. The news story that broke just in recent days, as reported by the New York Times, tells us that Eichmann had written a letter to the then president of Israel as he was approaching his execution, begging and pleading for his life. He wrote, quote, "There is a need to draw a line between the leaders responsible and the people like me forced to serve as mere instruments in the hands of the leaders." This was in a letter, handwritten by Adolf Eichmann, dated May 29, 1962. That was the very day that Israel's Supreme Court rejected his appeal. In the letter, Eichmann wrote to the Israeli president, he said, quote, "I was not a responsible leader, and as such, do not feel myself guilty," end quote. Now, we need to look as Christians at this very, very closely, because it is extremely revealing. Here we have the architect of Hitler's Final Solution, the architect of the Holocaust, which led to the deaths of between 6 and 7 million Jews and many others as well. We're looking at a man who, having been brought to the court of justice, the best justice that a human court could bring about, pled for his life saying that it wasn't his fault, that he really wasn't morally responsible. This letter had not been known even to have existed until it was released by the Israeli government this week. It was released by Israeli President Reuven Rivlin in connection with commemorations of International Holocaust Remembrance Day this very week. But as we heard the words from the letter, we also note something that we need to look at very carefully. Adolf Eichmann is making an argument for his life in this letter, pleading to the Israeli president. He is making the argument for his life based upon two very, very illuminating claims. The first is that, as he said, there is a need to draw a line between the leaders responsible and the people like me forced to serve as mere instruments in the hands of the leaders, end quote. Now, that argument failed for Eichmann on at least two grounds. The first is he was not merely a pawn in the Nazi leadership. Even though he was not in the very highest ranks of the Nazi leaders, there is no doubt, the historical record proves, he was front and center in the actual planning and plotting of the Final Solution. He took credit for it when the Nazi regime was in power. He was rightly condemned for it when he was arrested by Israel in 1960, eventually condemned for his crimes, and eventually executed. But that claim failed on a second ground, and that is this. It is not morally plausible to claim that you were merely ordered by your superiors to perform an inherently immoral act. In this case, an immoral act that extended to the murder of millions of people. But in this shocking letter from Eichmann that was released this week, there was the other sentence I read to you, and that is this. "I was not a responsible leader, and as such do not feel myself guilty," end quote. Upon reflection, that is one of the most shocking sentences any human being could write. Here you have a man, the historical record proves, was at the center of the planning and plotting of the Holocaust, a man who during his lifetime as a Nazi bragged about the effectiveness of what he called to be the Final Solution, and his statement in this letter was that he did not, to use his words, quote, "feel myself guilty," end quote. It is not only impossible in the year 2016 to read Adolf Eichmann's heart, it was impossible to read it in the year 1960, 61, or 62 when he was executed. We are not able to know whether he felt himself guilty or not, but the big point for us is this. It really doesn't matter, in terms of justice, whether he felt himself guilty or not. He was guilty. The historical record demonstrates himself to be guilty. That sentence demonstrates to us the human propensity, the enormous, almost unfathomable human capacity to delude ourselves about ourselves, to rationalize our own behavior, to create, as did Adam and Eve, fig leaves of a sort. We are better at creating fig leaves of moral argument in order to cover our own sin, to redefine it, to euphemize it, to call it something other than what it is, and to find ourselves not guilty. The release of this letter also brings to the forefront an enormous public conversation that took place about Adolf Eichmann not only in the 1960s but far beyond. The German-American philosopher Hannah Arendt famously argued as an observer at the Eichmann trial that Eichmann was a mere functionary. She found the greatest moral alarm in that if Adolf Eichmann could turn into this murderous monster, anyone could. The Christian worldview tells us that there is truth in Arendt's understanding. Any of us could turn into this kind of moral monster. As a matter of fact, the scripture is abundantly clear about this very thing. At the same time, it is also understood that in looking at someone like Adolf Eichmann and his henchmen in the Nazi regime, this was not something that came out of the blue all of a sudden as a recent development in his life. It was a deep-seated hatred that grew and abscessed and expanded and took over his life to the point that he was ready to become the architect of the final solution and to call the Jewish people, among others, Lebens und Wertensleben's, life unworthy of life. That didn't come out of a vacuum. There's another aspect of the story to which Christians should also pay attention, humbling attention. We look back to our knowledge of World War II and the Nazi years in Germany, and the Holocaust is front and center in what we now know, what we cannot, as a matter of fact, not know about the Nazi regime. The murder of multiple millions of people in the death camps. The use of a gas known as Zyklon B, designed in order to kill human beings. The use of crematories and the massive machinery of death that became the Holocaust of the Third Reich, this is now something we cannot not know. To think about World War II is not only to think about armies and countries at war, it is to think about a machinery of death unprecedented in human history. But that gets to my point. It wasn't really the fact that many people in even Western nations thought much about the Holocaust until the 1960s. It happened in the 1930s and 40s. It was well known and documented at the end of World War II. But as the world wanted to move on from World War II, it did its very best to move on from any memory of the Holocaust. It was the arrest and trial and execution of Adolf Eichmann in the 1960s that actually brought this to the world's attention in a way that renewed the awareness of what had happened. And the world had to come anew and again to the knowledge that there had been a regime that had targeted the Jewish people and had murdered them by the multiple millions. In order to have a name for this, the word genocide was actually coined as a new word to describe this intentional murder of an entire people by the millions. And after World War II, we became aware of the fact that genocide didn't begin with the Holocaust, nor did it end there. So as we look to the headlines about the release of this letter from Adolf Eichmann, written to the President of Israel pleading for his life in 1962, what should come to our mind is a knowledge of the weight of history, and the knowledge that the Holocaust did take place, the knowledge that the world allowed it to take place, and the knowledge that the world tried to put it out of its mind for any number of years after it was known. The release of this letter from Adolf Eichmann in the year 2016 should remind us of those words that haunt us, lest we forget. And we need to remember what is revealed in Fallen Humanity when we read these pathetic words from Adolf Eichmann: I was not a responsible leader, and as such, do not feel myself guilty. Hell, we should note, will be filled with those who never felt themselves guilty. Thanks for listening to The Briefing. For more information, go to my website at albertmohler.com. You can follow me on Twitter by going to twitter.com/Albert Mohler. For information on the Southern Baptist Theological Seminary, go to sbts.edu. For information on Boyce College, just go to boycecollege.com. I'll meet you again on Monday for The Briefing.
Draws me in, and all my eyes wanna see is a glimpse of you. All I need is you. All I need is you, Lord, is you, Lord.
putting on the Ritz.
Our God is an awesome God.
There's thunder in his footsteps and lightning in his fists.
Our God is an awesome God.
And the Lord wasn't joking when he kicked him out of Eden. It wasn't for no reason that he shed his blood. His return is very close, and so you better be believing that our God is an awesome God.
Our God.
The void of the night,
our God is an awesome God.
He spoke into the darkness and created the light.
Our God is an awesome God.
In judgment and wrath he poured out on Sodom. The mercy and grace he gave us at the cross. I hope that we have not too quickly forgotten that our God is an awesome God.
Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven.
Yeah.
Born Again, the late Rich Mullins before that, Awesome God, and Kim Walker with All I Need Is You. And that brings us up to our sermon teaching for this evening, entitled 40 Signs That Jesus Is Coming. Well, let's give a listen. God bless.
The Jerusalem Channel is made possible by viewer support. Thanks for watching.
There are so many signs that Jesus the Messiah will soon return, just as he promised, but many people will be caught unaware. And so I'm going to share with you my top 40 Bible signs of Jesus' coming again, so you'll be ready. Hello, I'm Christine Darg. Get ready in the next few minutes as I'll be going through the top 40 signs in the Bible predicted to indicate the second coming of Jesus. Sign number one was mentioned in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 24 and verse 33, that many false prophets and false teachers will introduce heresies, and they will unfortunately cause many persons to reject the truth of this Word of God. Today, because of the influence and media attention given to pop atheists and false teachers, tragically, many people are simply brainwashed into rejecting the Bible out of hand. It's the case of the old adage that if you hear a lie often enough, you'll begin to believe it. There's a proliferation of religious leaders who are only out for themselves. They'll say anything that sounds good to exploit you. Of course, they'll come to a bad end because God just never stands by and lets that kind of thing go on. Now, the second sign of the coming of the Lord is that Jesus' great commission in the New Testament predicted that the good news of forgiveness of sins and salvation through Jesus the Messiah will be preached as a witness to all nations. Did you know that the Bible or portions of this Bible have been translated into over 2,400 languages and dialects? That covers over 90% of the world's population. And through radio and television, the gospel is being preached and over the internet to all nations. That's why satellites are often referred to as angels. In the last book of the Bible, in Revelation chapter 14 and verse 6, John prophesied, "Then I saw another angel flying in midair, and he had the eternal gospel to proclaim to those on earth who live and to every nation, tribe, language, and people." Sign number three is perhaps the biggest sign, and that is the sign of the regathering of the nation of Israel. Many prophecies, such as Isaiah 11:11, Ezekiel chapters 37, 38, and 39, and Jesus' own prediction in Luke chapter 21, clearly foretold that the Jewish people would be regathered in the land of Israel in the last days. Never until our generation has a nation that's been dispersed to every corner of the globe been regathered back to their ancient homeland. Well, the Bible said Israel would become a wasteland when the Jews were expelled from their country. Indeed, during the past 1900 years, the land of Israel became a desolate wasteland. But according to a specific prophecy, Isaiah 66:8, Israel suddenly became a nation again in one day on May 14, 1948. Jews have returned from the north, south, east, and west, as predicted by the prophets Isaiah and Jeremiah. Jews have immigrated from Europe, Asia, the Americas, from everywhere. Nearly 1 million Jews have immigrated from Russia in the north. Once a desert, Israel is blossoming and exporting produce to the world. Israel's rainfall has increased now that the Jews are back, and their world-renowned irrigation technology have caused the land to blossom and fill the world with fruit and flowers. So sign number four is that Israel is literally booming and prospering economically as a great startup nation after laying barren for nearly two millennia. And this economic prosperity is happening while many nations are hurting economically, and despite the fact that many anti-Semites are attempting to boycott this nation. But God had promised through the prophets Joel, Amos, and Isaiah that Israel would plant vineyards and trees. And since 1900, more than a billion trees have been planted in Israel. The Hebrew language is sign number five. In the 19th century, the Zionist movement revived Hebrew, and one man, Eliezer ben Yehuda, wrote a modern Hebrew dictionary and published a newspaper in Hebrew, and he almost single-handedly revived the ancient language. In this photo, I'm talking with ben Yehuda's grandson, Rabbi Eliezer ben Yehuda, who bears the same name as his famous grandfather, and who's also involved with editing the Hebrew edition of the Rosetta Stone language program. Well, it's never happened before that an ancient liturgical language used only in synagogues has been resurrected and is now spoken on the streets of Jerusalem, just like the prophets. Think about that. Sign number six is the city of Jerusalem itself. Jesus predicted that Jerusalem would once again be in Jewish hands in the last days. His disciples had asked Jesus if he would, at that time, restore the kingdom of David to Israel. But Jesus lamented in his Olivet Discourse in Luke 21:24 that first the holy city would be trampled down by the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles would be fulfilled. Well, it's taken nearly 2,000 years for the times of the Gentiles to be fulfilled. Since 70 AD, Jerusalem had been trampled and controlled by Gentiles. But then miraculously, the Jews regained control of their capital city in 1967 in the Six-Day War. So keep your eyes upon this major sign, the sign of Jerusalem, because the nations are trying to impose their solutions on Israel's capital. But God says through the prophet Zechariah that Jerusalem cannot be moved. The United Nations, the Vatican, and many world leaders want to make Jerusalem an international city. However, God says that the city is His, and He has given it to the Jewish people. Well, sign seven is the terrible sign of worldwide anti-Semitism. History confirms that the Jewish people have been persecuted like no other people. Hitler tried to exterminate them, and the Antichrist to come will attempt to destroy them during the tribulation, but he will fail, because the God of Israel is the guardian of the destiny of his Jewish people. Today, anti-Semitism is a global epidemic. Well, sign eight is the sign of Psalm 83, which says that all of Israel's surrounding neighbors would be united against Israel. Truly today, Israel is surrounded by Muslim nations sworn to her destruction. Well, number nine is the Bible fact that Israel is supernaturally invincible. Since 1948, tiny Israel has been attacked in three major wars and several lesser wars. Yet, despite being vastly outnumbered, the Jews have defeated all of their attacking foes. Even during the final battle in the future, when it looks like Israel may be destroyed, the Lord promises to intervene and to save His people. Sign 10 is that the Bible predicted that the land of Israel would be partitioned by all nations according to Joel chapter 3 and verse 2 and Daniel chapter 11 and verse 39. In 1947, UN Resolution 181 planned the partitioning of the land of Israel, which God stated is really his land, and it angers him, he said, that nations have parted my land, and that they continue to try to do so by attempting to create another Palestinian state. Sign 11, keep your eyes on Jerusalem's Eastern Gate. As a matter of fact, our ministry used to have a web camera focused on the Eastern Gate, watching for Messiah's return and focusing upon that doctrine, until some building construction unfortunately obliterated our view. Well, the Bible says in Ezekiel chapter 44 in verses 1 to 3 that the Eastern Gate, sometimes called the Golden Gate, will remain shut until Messiah returns. Sign 12. The Jews who return to Israel will have no king until Jesus returns. That's according to the prophet Hosea in chapter 3, verses 4 to 5. Indeed, Israel has been without a king for over 2,500 years. Presently, Israel is not a theocracy, but it's a democratic state governed by a Knesset, a parliament, with multiple political parties. But King Jesus is coming to rule. Sign 13, the ancient Jewish temple will be rebuilt. In the Bible, the prophet Daniel, Jesus the Messiah, as well as the apostles Paul and John, all refer to the temple as being a reality in the last days. And the Temple Institute in Jerusalem's Jewish quarter has created the furniture, the vessels, and the priestly garments for the third temple. Sign 14 is Iran, the biblical nation of Persia, mentioned as one of the troublesome nations that will come against restored Israel in the last days, according to Ezekiel chapter 38. And according to the Quran, Muslims are commanded to fight non-believers in so-called holy war, unless they convert to Islam. So watch the nation of Iran, as well as sign number 15, which is the nation of Turkey. And many scholars say Turkey is Gomer, mentioned in Ezekiel 38. Turkey will also join in the attack on Israel. In 2002, Turkey elected a pro-Islamic party to govern the nation. In 2005, Hitler's anti-Semitic manifesto, Mein Kampf, became a bestseller in Turkey. And in 2007, Turkey elected an Islamist president. And increasingly, Turkey has become at odds with Israel, such as the Gaza flotilla incident in 2010. Sign 16 is the global cry for peace, as predicted in the New Testament in 1 Thessalonians 5:3. Never has there been such a concerted global effort to bring about peace at any price. But we won't need to deal with the question when all of this is going to happen, because you know as well as I do that the day of the Lord's coming can't be posted on our calendars. He's not going to call ahead and make any appointment with anybody, just like a burglar wouldn't. About the time that everybody is congratulating each other, saying, we can take it easy, we finally have peace and security, the Bible says suddenly everything will fall apart. It's going to come as quickly as birth pangs come to a pregnant woman. Sign 17 is found in Isaiah 17, verses 1 and 14. Watch Damascus, the capital of Syria, because it will be destroyed. The Bible says it will be a heap of ruins. Damascus is increasingly in the news and extremely anti-Semitic. Many terrorist organizations have bases in Damascus. Sign 18. Today's global telecommunications were predicted in the book of Revelation, chapter 11, and also in chapter 17, verse 8. The Bible prophesies that the entire world will see certain events unfolding. The invention of computers, television, satellite networks, mobile phones, handsets, and tablets make it possible for news to travel the world at the speed of light. And remember that In John's day, news traveled at the speed of horseback. So sign 19 is that the human species will be capable of destroying all life. When Jesus made this prophecy in Matthew 24 and verse 22, the weapons of his day were swords and shields and spears. But today, with nuclear, biological, and chemical weapons, it's possible to wipe out all flesh on this earth. The use of nuclear weapons is also graphically pictured in Zechariah chapter 14 and verse 12, which says that flesh shall dissolve while people stand on their feet, and eyes will dissolve in their sockets, and that tongues shall melt in the mouths of people. The neutron bomb melts and dissolves its victims, just as God warned 2,500 years ago. Sign 20 is the chaotic weather. It's not new, but we've been witnessing an increase in strange and freakish weather. In Luke 21:25, Jesus foresaw tsunamis by saying that the seas and the waves will roar in the last days. He also likened these weather signs to birth pangs. Furthermore, the Apostle Paul reminded us that the creation will be delivered from the curse at the end of the age, and that the whole creation, Paul says, groans with birth pangs. And therefore, the creation itself will go into travail as the end times grow closer. Sign 21 is the move toward a global government as predicted by the prophet Daniel and the book of Revelation. The former Roman Empire, which encompassed present-day Europe, will revive and eventually dominate the world. The European Union has steadily moved forward in its attempt to unite Europe, politically and economically. It succeeded and created a European Parliament, a European Court, and even a common currency. And some teachers predict that the Ottoman Empire will revive to rule the world before Jesus returns. Sign 22, that many wars will continue to erupt and the earth will be filled with violence. And as I speak, there are dozens of armed conflicts in the world today. Never in history have so many nations stockpiled so many weapons of mass destruction. A number of decades ago, the violent murder of an unborn child was illegal in most countries. But now, some statistics report that 46 million children are aborted every year. That's equivalent to the population of many nations. Sign 23. Multitudes of people will have access to travel, according to a prophecy in Daniel chapter 12 and verse 4. Think about this. Prior to the Industrial Revolution, few individuals ever were able to venture beyond their own villages for their entire lifetime. Only the privileged had access to travel. Until recent history, going by foot, by horse, by stagecoach, or boats were the only modes of transportation. Yet today we can travel by subway, bus, car, train, ocean liners, and jet airplanes. Millions of people are traveling to and fro, just as Daniel prophesied so long ago. Sign 24 is the exponential explosion in knowledge and technology, as also prophesied in Daniel 12:4. With the advent of the internet, it's estimated that knowledge doubles every 5 years. This exponential increase is beyond what anyone could have imagined in past times. Sign 25, according to Revelation 13:16, the final generation will be technologically set up so that consumers will receive a mark on their right hand or on their forehead in order to buy and sell. Already, tattoos, piercings, and frequent marks on the skin are becoming increasingly acceptable and fashionable. Today, for the first time in history, global tracking and marking technology is available to accomplish the mark of the beast. This was unthinkable in the Apostle John's day. Yet today, globalists in every level of government are seeking to unite the world. Sign 26. Just a few decades ago, some scientists were forecasting that medical advances might soon eradicate all deadly diseases. But despite an explosion in medical knowledge, Jesus said that deadly viruses and pestilences will characterize the last days. A recurrent theme in movies dramatizes just how plausible is a worldwide contagion and epidemic. Certainly, epidemic already is drug abuse, both illegal drugs and mind-altering drugs. Sign 27, famines were prophesied by Jesus in Luke 21 and also in Revelation 6. According to the United Nations, an estimated near 900 million persons went hungry in a recent year. Sign 28, great and fearful signs from heaven were prophesied in the Olivet Discourse, and also the prophesied time of the blood moons of the prophet Joel that we entered into in Passover 2014. These signs are God's billboard in the skies, telling us to look up, that our redemption is drawing near. Sign 29 is that there will also be signs not only in the moon, but in the sun, perhaps solar flares. Watch all signs in the heavens, because the heavens declare the glory of God, and He is going to show portents to signal the end of this age. Sign 30 is the rise of Asia. According to the book of Revelation, the East will be capable of deploying a 200 million man army during the last days. When the Apostle John penned that prophecy so many years ago, there were only an estimated couple hundred million people on the entire planet. Yet today, according to one source, China alone has 280 million men fit for military service. Sign 31, earthquakes and tsunamis are making frequent news headlines. Seismic activity is one of the powerful indicators the Bible warned us about. And sign 32 concerns the state of marriage. Paul said in 1 Timothy that marriage would be forbidden by many. Although the Bible states that marriage is honorable, the Catholic Church forbids hundreds of thousands of priests, nuns, monks, bishops, cardinals, from enjoying the benefits of marriage, and this has contributed to the problem of pedophilia and other sins in the church. Jesus himself said that the last days would be like the days of Lot, when sodomy and sexual perversions were prevalent. Therefore, following on is sign 33, the prediction of rampant sexual immorality. Access to pornography has exploded in our generation. If Jesus said that adultery can be committed in the heart, then engaging in internet porn or looking at pornographic magazines and movies is equivalent to fornication and adultery. Nearly every movie includes some form of blasphemy or immorality. The world is just awash with sexual perversions. May God have mercy on our children. End time sign 34 is inordinate self-love. The Apostle Paul said that people would be totally self-centered and increasingly rebellious. Even the mainstream churches emphasize feel-good messages about self-esteem and worldly success. But sign 35 is worldwide persecution of all true believers. Jesus said his disciples will be hated by all men for his sake. The banning of prayer, the Ten Commandments, nativity scenes, and so forth reflects this growing trend. More Christians have been martyred during the past century than during all previous history. As I speak, many believers are in prison and being murdered in places such as Northern Nigeria, Pakistan, Iran, Saudi Arabia, North Korea, accused of blasphemy and all sorts of false charges for faithfully sharing the gospel. Sign 36 sounds like science fiction, but according to the Bible, the last days will be like the days of Noah, when the Bible says fallen angels interacted with men. During the past decades, there's been an explosion of UFO sightings. The deception of fallen angels will appear again at the end of the age. And sign 37 is the great apostasy as churchgoers reject sound doctrine, forsaking the Bible and looking increasingly to churchmen in Rome rather than to Jerusalem, where Jesus will return. Rampant replacement theology increasingly denies that God will once again pass the gospel baton to the Jews. God commands us to pray for the peace of Jerusalem and to minister mercy to the Jews in their time of regathering. But instead, in the mainline churches, there's an invasion of witchcraft, yoga, and other forbidden practices in the Bible, and attempts to divest the church from the Jews. Sign 38 has come to the fore in the news more recently, and that is that the Muslim coalition that will attack the Holy Land, according to Ezekiel chapter 38 and 39, will be led by Russia. Have you noticed lately how aggressive the Russian bear is becoming? Numerous historical references make it plain that Magog in Ezekiel 38 stands for modern Russia, and the other countries named in that chapter form a coalition. Directly or indirectly, the Russians are already a supplier of arms for the nations who will form this coalition against Israel. Sign 39 concerns Babylon. According to the book of Revelation, Babylon will emerge as a prominent force or city in the last days. Bible scholars are divided on whether this is literal Babylon, which Saddam Hussein began to rebuild, or if it refers to Mecca or Rome. There are several religious systems that would seem to fit the bill. And finally, we've come in this program to sign 40, which is mockery of the second coming. Today, people mock this kind of message, saying, oh yeah, so what? These signs have always been around. But here's the question I want to leave you with. Are you ready for the second coming? If your answer is no, or if you're not sure, I've got good news. If you're willing to repent of your sins and to receive Jesus the Messiah as your Savior, He will receive you and save you, regardless of your religious background, your ethnic background, or past sins. All you need to do is to be willing to put your faith in Jesus' finished work of atonement on the cross. Dare to say with me, Father God in heaven, I do believe in my heart that you raised Messiah Jesus from the dead, and I confess with my mouth that Jesus is Lord. Amen. I pray the Holy Spirit will give you further revelation. And if you'd like to chat on Facebook or Twitter, I'm here for you. Also, please visit our website at exploits.tv, where you can click online to receive our free magazine, Exploits. Until next time, contending for the faith, I'm Christine Darg. Shalom. Psalm 122 commands us to pray for the peace of this city, and it promises that all who love Jerusalem shall prosper. The Jerusalem Channel gives you the opportunity to be a watchman upon the walls 24/7, and we have available to you more than 100 videos that are absolutely free online to everybody in the world. But we need you to be one of the supporters. We need you to be a watchman for the Jerusalem Channel and to surround us with your love and prayers. If you're watching from the United States, please know that your donation is tax deductible. And if you are a viewer and one of our watchmen in the United Kingdom, we are a registered charity, and that helps us so much when you support us. In the meantime, we invite you to come up to Jerusalem and keep the festivals of the Lord with us and to be part of our prayer conferences. Support the Jerusalem Channel as you pray for the peace of Jerusalem and love this city. God, I'm sure, is well pleased. I'm Christine Darg, wishing you shalom and peace from the city of the great King. We'll be right back.
Thank you for being with Jerry the Blues Man. We'll see you next time on the Dusty Road Show. That's from 5 p.m. to 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. God bless and have a great evening.
There's a new world to come in. Come on and find the way. There's a new world to come in. It's a dawning of a new day.
Oh, happy day.
When Jesus was,
when Jesus was,
when Jesus was,
he washed my sins away.
Oh, happy day.
Oh, it's a happy day.
Oh, 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 happy day.
When Jesus was,
when Jesus was.
When Jesus was,
when Jesus was,
when Jesus was,
he washed
my sins away.
Oh, happy day.
Oh, it's a happy day.
Oh, happy day.